Welcome back, everybody. Let's start a new chapter of our course. Specifically, let's start talking about power analysis. And power analysis is really cool. Remember, when we collect data, our goal is to find the truth. Well, sometimes the truth is that there are differences in the groups that we're trying to compare, and we want to maximize the probability of finding those differences. That's what power is all about. Power is the probability of finding differences when they really do exist. A power analysis will help us understand the factors that lead to finding statistically significant results when they do exist. In this video, I want to review some of those key issues and make sure that you understand power and what it really is. And then, in future videos in this short series, we'll talk specifically at length about key factors that influence power, and then we'll talk about two different types of power analyses that we're going to perform. An a priori power analysis and a post hoc power analysis. But let's begin with a brief review of hypothesis testing so that we can see where power fits into that four-step process. By now, you're pretty familiar with that four-step hypothesis testing process. And the bottom line is, we're trying to figure out information about some unknown population parameter, specifically, usually, a population mean, mu. And via that four-step hypothesis testing procedure, we are able to draw accurate conclusions about that unknown population parameter a large proportion of the time. But keep in mind, sometimes we make errors, and we've talked a lot about type 1 errors, because type 1 errors are not good. Type 1 errors are when we conclude we have statistically significant results. So for example, statistically significant differences between groups, and we are wrong because there are no differences at all. That is what a type 1 error is. And you might recall, we have some control over making a type 1 error via the alpha level. The alpha level dictates how much evidence we need to find statistically significant results. So if we set that alpha level to 0.05, 5%, then at least theoretically speaking, the probability over the long run of making a type 1 error is 5%. As I mentioned, we have some control over making those errors, so we might decide as a discipline that we need more evidence to find statistically significant results. So we might change that alpha level from a 0.05 to a 0.01. That would mean we would need more evidence to find statistically significant results, but it would also mean that over the long run, we would make type 1 errors only 1% of the time. So you might be thinking, let's just use really small alpha levels, like an alpha level of 0.01 or even less. But you have to keep in mind there's a trade-off that occurs. And that's because as we lower that alpha level from 0.05 to 0.01 or something even smaller like 0.001, we do need more evidence in those situations and we will make type 1 errors fewer times. However, we are more likely in those situations to make type 2 errors. You might recall that type 2 errors happen when real differences do exist. There are indeed differences between groups, but we don't have enough evidence within our sample data to find those differences. In other words, we don't have enough evidence to find statistically significant results. This chapter of our course is all about type 2 errors. Now you might be thinking, wait a minute, I thought you said this chapter of our course is all about power. Well, power is the probability of not making a type 2 error. So as we talk about power, you should always be thinking about type 2 errors, because power literally is the probability of not making a type 2 error. This table right here does a good job of distinguishing between type 1 and type 2 errors and helping you understand the interplay between type 2 errors and power. If we really understand the details within that table, then we're going to really understand power analyses. So let's change the views and look at that table a little bit more closely. This table looks at two primary factors. One is the actual situation as it exists in the real world. So we went through an example previously where we were looking at the mean birth weight of babies born addicted to crack. And the null hypothesis was that they were just like normal healthy babies. They weighed 8 pounds. But the alternative was that they weighed something other than 8 pounds. Well, my point for bringing that up is one of those is true. The actual situation in the real world is that they weigh the same as normal healthy babies or they don't. In other words, when it comes to the actual situation in the real world, an effect either exists, meaning the null hypothesis is false, or there is no effect, meaning that the null hypothesis is true. The other key factor in this table regards our decision. So we're either going to reject that null hypothesis and conclude that there are differences between those populations, or we're going to fail to reject the null hypothesis and conclude that those populations of babies are equal in terms of their weight. Well, keep in mind, when it comes to the actual situation in the real world, only one of those two things can be true at any given time. So in this example, either there is no effect and babies born addicted weigh the same as normal healthy babies, or indeed there is an effect and babies born addicted weigh something other than 8 pounds, which is the average weight of normal healthy babies. Only one of those things can be true at any given time. So when we pick apart this table and look real closely at these probabilities, it makes sense to look at each situation separately, one at a time. And let's first look at the left side of that table and assume a situation when the null hypothesis is true and there are no effects, no differences. We know that our disciplines, for the most part, dictate what alpha level we're going to use. And we know that an alpha level of 0.05 is very common. What that means, at least theoretically speaking, is that when there is no effect and there are no differences between groups, we will conclude that there are differences about 5% of the time. So about 5% of the time, we will make a type 1 error. Well, in those situations when there is no effect, when the null hypothesis is true, if we're going to make a type 1 error 5% of the time, that means 95% of the time, we're going to make the correct decision. Now let's talk about the other side of this table. Remember, when it comes to the real world, it's possible that an effect actually does exist. In this case, it's possible that babies born addicted do weigh something other than 8 pounds. So for right now, let's assume that's true. Let's say that babies born addicted are lighter than normal healthy babies. They do indeed weigh less than 8 pounds. In this situation, you can see it's impossible to make a type 1 error. It's impossible for us to conclude that differences exist and be wrong, because if we conclude that differences exist, we will be correct. It is, however, possible that we could make a type 2 error. It's possible that differences really do exist, that's what we're assuming right now, but that we won't have enough evidence to find them. Well, when we were talking about type 1 errors, we said it was very common to have type 1 errors about 5% of the time. So you might assume that the probability of making a type 2 error might be right around that level as well, about 5%. If the probability of making a type 2 error is 5%, then that would mean the probability of not making a type 2 error is 95%, and that in this situation would be our power level. However, determining our power level isn't quite that easy. And that's because a variety of factors influence our probability of finding differences that do indeed exist. Many people believe that a minimum acceptable level of power is 0.80. That would mean a minimum acceptable level of power is having an 80% chance of finding differences when indeed they really do exist. That would also mean that over the long run, we'd be making type 2 errors about 20% of the time. And remember, I stated that 80% is a minimum acceptable power level. If possible, we'd like to increase that probability of finding differences, because making type 2 errors 20% of the time, in my mind, that's unacceptable. So before we run a research study, we would want to do a power analysis to determine how much evidence would we need to jack up this value. How much evidence would we need? How much data would we need to collect to have a power level that's above 80%? Because when differences do indeed exist, I want to find them. You might recall learning early on in our course that probability and proportion of area are equal. So let's change views and look at a couple distributions, and I'm going to show you how the area in those distributions can help us compute power. We are going to pick apart this graphic in detail, because you can see just based on the labels that we are going to be able to compute power just based on finding an area, a specific area in this distribution. If you need to relearn or refamiliarize yourself with some of these labels, they're all defined for you right down here. But for right now, let's change views and look at this graphic more closely. I have this graphic labeled up for a really interesting example that demonstrates something called the Flynn effect. And the Flynn effect essentially says that over time, we get smarter. Over time, I hope you individually get smarter, but this effect is really looking at our population. In general, we as a population are smarter than the population of human beings from like 30 years ago. That could be demonstrated if we today were to take an IQ test that was normed from 30 years ago. Because 30 years ago, when people were taking that IQ test, the average score would be 100. If we took that exact same IQ test today, based on the current population of people, we would score greater than 100. So in other words, the Flynn effect is essentially saying our collective intelligence level increases over time. If we wanted to test this question, we'd set up two competing hypotheses. Of course, the null hypothesis would be that the population mean IQ score, if we were to take this test today, would equal 100. In other words, the population mean IQ today is equivalent to the population mean IQ 30 years ago. And then the alternative would be that the population mean IQ today is something other than 100, something other than what it was 30 years ago. And then we would create a distribution of all possible sample means based on that null hypothesis being true. So right in the middle of that distribution would be a mean IQ of 100. And then depending on our alpha level, we would figure out where that critical value is. Just for demonstration purposes, let's assume that in this situation, that critical value transforms into a mean IQ of 118. In other words, in order to reject the null hypothesis, we would need to find a sample mean that exceeds that value. Okay, here's where things get interesting, and also just a little bit different from the way we saw things before. We know right now that the Flynn effect exists. We know that if people took an IQ test from 30 years ago, they would do better than 100. And let's assume, just for demonstration purposes, that the difference that we would see after these 30 years would be a difference of 10 points, so that the mean IQ, if people were to take that test today, would be 110. What that means is that the distribution of all possible sample means, based on the Flynn effect being true, looks more like this. So we would expect to see lots of sample means right around 110. But remember, we would need to find a sample mean that exceeds 118 in order to find statistically significant results. All of the sample means that exceed 118 are all of the sample means beyond that critical value. And all of the sample means that exceed that critical value are in this region right here. That area, my friends, represents the statistical power associated with our test. So if we can calculate that proportion of area, we can figure out how likely it is to find statistically significant results given that they do indeed exist. You can see in this example, we're not going to have very much statistical power. That mean IQ of 110 splits this distribution right here, right down the middle. That means half of the distribution is to the right of it. You can see that the area in here that we're concerned with is not even half the distribution. So in this case, our power level, it's even less than 50%. Maybe it's somewhere around 40%, 35%. That would mean we only have a 35 or 40% chance of finding statistically significant differences that actually do exist. I hope you would agree that that's terrible. Those are terrible odds. We would not want to embark in a study that has a low probability of being successful. This is the exact reason for why we need to do a power analysis. Because if we do a power analysis before we begin a study, we will know how much data we need to collect to maximize our chances of finding those differences. Because the good news is that some factors that maximize statistical power are within our control. And if we make the right decisions before we start our research study, we can maximize the probability of being successful. And that's what I want to do in the next video. I want to discuss four key factors that affect statistical power. Not all of those factors are within our control, but some of them are. We'll discuss those in the next video. In the meantime, be safe.